Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a very warm welcome to the Reinvention Laboratory. I'm Corinna Agra, your host during this Reinvention Lab Week. Content management and content delivery, that's the topic we have ahead of us now in this session. And to just give you a brief overview of what we are gonna, how we're gonna structure it, we will first hear an introductory speech, and then we'll have three little panel discussions on three different topics that we'll each have introduced by an expert. So yeah, I think we'll touch a variety of topics within this session. Introductory speech. Let me introduce our first speaker. It is Dietmar Schantin, and he is founder of the Institute for Media Strategies. As digitalization expert in the media industry, he has an external view on our discussion, certainly about developments in standardization. So he might provide us with some very interesting additional insights and views or aspects. Dietmar, look forward to your presentation. The floor is yours.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak. This is totally unusual for me because usually I talk to peers from the media industry and I tell them what other companies or other industries do. In this case, it's the other way around. So I will try to share with you how the media industry and especially the news media industry has reacted to the changes in the digital space and how the user also has influenced the organization of a publishing house, the people, the staff, the organization in general. What we do, just one word, we support brands, news media brands around the globe with their digitalization strategy. When it is about how to get the newsrooms, the advertising departments, into the digital world, how to use technology and to basically reach their audiences much better, to engage them, to not basically lose them to the Googles and the Facebooks to the world. And we have been doing this now for over 10 years, and we have learned a little bit how the best ways look like if it comes to changing a traditional organization, a content organization, to a digital organization. And here I think there are quite a lot of similarities because after all, a newspaper produces content and tries to distribute it and hopefully has a lot of audience that basically pays for it. And there might be similarities to the standardization industry. Basically, why is it so important for news media to change and to digitize their businesses? Because their customers have changed. They want and expect easy access to content. They want to have it anytime, any place, any device. They unfortunately are not very loyal anymore, and this might be a difference to you, to your industry, because there are so many news outlets out there, and who offers the best digital experience or the best experience in general will get the eyeballs, will get the audience. So there is no loyalty in terms of brands anymore. And also, they want to be engaged. Just receiving content or receiving news or any other content is not enough anymore. They want to be engaged and be involved in the communication flow. And this has changed the concept of how a publishing house works in a tremendous way. So what media houses try to do is they try to create a multi-platform communication flow. And I would like to run you briefly through how this communication flow looks like. It is basically always about an editorial, a content generation process to an audience, the target groups. And then there are different tools media houses have today, and these are platforms usually. There's mobile phone, there's a website, there's a video or TV, and there's a printed version that usually is either every day or every week. So, and what the media houses now have tried to do is to just get away from this print focus and try to catch the audience around all these platforms. So if something happens, basically they put something out on social media so that people can get it on their mobile phone. Over 60% in many cases of the traffic to any news outlet is now on a mobile phone. We predict actually that in 5 to 10 years there won't be a desktop web page anymore. It will be all on mobile. Then something gets on the web page. Then, of course, there's always cross-referencing. This is very important for media to tell people, we have something here on this media, but why don't you come also here? Because we have it better or in a different way here. They produce videos, again, with cross-referencing, a video story. And then they put it in the newspaper in the evening for the next day's publication, again with cross-references. In the media industry, we have to wait then 24 hours at least, or maybe a week or month, depending on the frequency of the publication. But digital is a 24/7 media. So basically, they send the audience back to the digital outlets and say, if you want to have an update, don't wait for the paper the next day. We have an update here on our website or on the mobile phone, and so on and so on. So in this circle is something that becomes more and more important for the media industry to cope with and to organize, because it's getting very complex. In the past, there was one journalist wrote the story, an editor edited it, and then it was sent to the printing plant, and then it was published in hundreds of thousands of copies, and that's it. And every day, next day, all counters were set to zero again, and the next publication was started. And this has completely changed over the last few years. So what most, and not all of them, are, if all media houses would do it right, I wouldn't have a job. So what most of them try is basically to follow a simple motto, to give people what they want in the form, how they want it, on the device they want it, in the use for the certain specific moment. So understanding how the audience, how the customer is using content or using devices becomes more and more important. So this outside-in view is something that is a total cultural shift in the media industry, because in the past it was always an inside-out view. We know we are the best journalists in the world, we have all the wisdom, and we share our wisdom with our audience, and this is why we call it newspaper and printed. So this has totally changed over the last few years. What also has changed is what type of jobs you can find in a media house today. So there are loads of more new fields of expertise are required in a modern media house. In the past, again, it was someone who could write the text, take some pictures, put it on a page, do the layout, and then basically printing, that's it. And this has also, especially in the last few years, with more and more new technologies coming out, has changed even more so. But what are the new fields of expertise? And this is something where you would think this is natural, but just the skill to understand the audience, to understand the customer, audience insight, customer insight, market research, is not in the DNA of a publishing house. There's always inside out, never outside in, listening what the customer wants. So customer audience insight. Social media, the term that is used is distributed content. Facebook and Snapchat, they are basically eating away audience and advertising money. So to know how to work with social media becomes crucial for every media house. User experience, customer journey. I'm sure you have the same experience when you sometimes go to a newspaper website or any website, that the user experience doesn't work. But everything that is more complicated now than an Apple iPhone or Android, people don't accept it anymore. It needs to be easy and simple. Naturally, there was no skill whatsoever in terms of how to create a positive user experience. Apple taught us how to do it, and as an industry, and they still need to build up this know-how. Multimedia storytelling. Pictures and text is one thing, but there's video, infographics, everything that is to do with rich media. There's the whole concept of hyperlinking and these kind of things. This is something that is also for many journalists still a challenge, because they're used to text and pictures. So just to get to enhance content, to make it more engaging, to make it more interesting, is something that is not very common in traditional newsrooms. And I think, I don't know how many videos, for example, are uploaded to YouTube every second. So people become more visual and less text. Then multi-platform and multi-device publishing. The session is about content management. Sounds easy, but to have a decent content management system that can manage everything from the creation of the content to the distribution and also the feedback costs a lot of money and needs a lot of expertise. Again, not used to it. Data management and analytics. nothing that is traditional in any publishing house, to understand the analytics from the user behavior and so on, to actually interpret it and make decisions based on it, completely new. And finally, digital sales. How do I get my product to the customer? They were used to basically just send it out to the kiosk and then it's bought. But anything that has to do with digital sale, they have never learned it. So the main challenges of the technology on the technology side come directly from these new skills. It's about multi-channel content management systems and multi-format. This is something that is still not solved. Suppliers in the industry are usually 3 to 4 years behind the developments. E-commerce platforms, performance response measurement, user journey tracking and optimization tools. Sounds easy, extremely complex, because usually the data of a customer is in about 15 different databases, and nobody actually has managed to bring this into a so-called 360-degree view. And the topic of data management, analysts. To analyze the huge amount of data, and I'm sure you have heard that the data is the new gold in the communication industry, because with data, you know your customer, you know it helps you to decide what to produce, when to produce, and where to produce it. So these are all only four lines, but this keeps our industry awake. And also the suppliers for this industry actually good in business. So what have some publishers done? Some of them basically invested in startups and merged with technology companies because they learned they can't build it up themselves. Some hired people from other industries. For example, Financial Times has people from Amazon because Amazon knows how to sell in the digital space. Or outsourcing what is really not part of the core business, which would be basically everything that is connected to finance and the IT part and focusing on the media part only and get the resources focusing on this. So these are the main steps and main points that the media industry does to try to get digital into their organization and also from the beginning to the end. I hope I was able to share a little bit and give you an insight what is happening there, and happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.
Dietmar, stay here with us, with me, and yes, we will indeed look if the audience has some questions, and if you do so, please feel free to ask and just tell us your name and the organization where you're from so we know the perspective you're taking.
Roland Hussein from Toronto.
Hello.
When you look at the speed of the information, it's real time, you talk about all of the elements, but what about the integrity of the information? How do you maintain truth when you're moving fast?
It's a very good question. Depends very much on the brand. As we know, there are some brands that focus more on the speed. If you take Sky and BBC, Sky might be the first. BBC is the one to check the story once more time. The trend is more going towards quality again, because you can't differentiate yourself in the long run with speed, because everyone can be fast, but only a few can be reliable. But this is something that was overdone in the past really heavily, to be first, 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 first. So this trend is going back into quality for some publications, not for all of them. Some are still putting speed at the first. But it is one of the biggest problems for journalism to check a story if it's really true or not. I think there was this, I don't know if you followed the story of Corbyn in BBC, where he was basically sitting on a train and the Guardian didn't check the story, just published it. Big problem.
Dietmar, I found the presentation very interesting, and actually I've been asking myself, if you had to reorganize standardization work, where would you start? Would you send standardization managers to the Silicon Valley, or what would you do?
No. Silicon Valley is very interesting, is very inspiring, but it's all about, and this is true for many industries, and I'm sure it also can be applied for standardization industry, is understanding the customer, understanding what really, how does he use what you produce, mm-hmm. where does he use it, in what form? So this is all the starting points, this is the starting point for any change. Okay. And this is something that many industries, especially also us, we have to learn to listen to the customer, to understand the customer, not necessarily to ask the customer, mm-hmm. but to get this empathy, and then from there on, starting to build up how the content looks like, to enrich the content, to make it more compelling. Because as far as I remember in my studies, standardization books were not really engaging, so they were quite dry. So and it's very, back then, of course, 25 years ago, text-based. And with new ways of explaining things, mm-hmm. with new media, it can be even a dry topic mm-hmm. can become more alive.
Yeah, so more colorful, I think this world.
This would be, it's also something that we can use so many technologies to do this.
Okay. Well, thank you for now. We'll make this stage now a little bit more colorful. Stay here with me, Dietmar.
Okay.
And I will ask our panelists now on stage. And while I introduce them, I'd like maybe we can have the chairs for the panel discussion here. Dietmar, you're staying with me then. Martin Danvers, he's from British National Committee and head of Technical Policy, British Standards Institution, BSI. Take a seat together with Dietmar. And then Clemens, where are you there? He's a young professional product manager at Siemens AG in Germany. And Dr. Stefan Kloska, he is head of EMC Acoustics Laboratories in the VDE Testing and Certification Institute. And you're bringing your hands on, you're bringing your own chair. Yeah, great. Great. Great to have you here. So, and last but not least, for introduction, I would like to ask on stage Klaus-Wolfgang Klingner. He is Division Manager Standards at DKE German National Committee. Klaus-Wolfgang, the floor is yours. You will talk about content delivery near future.
Thank you. Yes, what I want to show you, Dietmar talked about the data and said data is the new gold, and I want to show you our vision, what we can do with the data of our standards. You all know when I, as young engineer, started my career with my first products, and my boss came and said to me, "Yo, you have to test it for EMC, and here are the standards. Please read it." It was a thick packet of standards, and to read it is very difficult. I could not ask a question to these books. And that is our first idea, that you can say, have a software and you can talk to it and ask a question. How do I determine the cleaning efficiency of dishwashers? And on the next, you get a list of standards, but not only a list of standards, you also get a hint that there is a new development for a standard for commercial dishwashers, and you can bring your name on a list for the new draft, or if there is a new standard. Also, like you know it from Amazon, you can see someone who asked this question is also of interest for some videos about this topic, or some special data sheets, or maybe you're interested in some books, a book about energy efficiency, or a book of the usage of dishwashers in the household. That is all a simple idea. Behind the next click, you find the standard, the usual the text as we know it, but even there you'll find, okay, you see here the test for spinach, and you can click here and can may see a video which shows you how you have to test it, because reading the text is okay, but it needs a long time and you have not the impression how to do it. Just in a short video you see how someone else does this test, and you have more idea. Even you can have a discussion forum, like we have it here with our app, that you can write your comments, what is your experience with this test, and maybe you get some answers from others in the World Wide Web. Mm-hmm. Also, next idea, if you are, for example, a German, maybe you needed the text in English because you discuss with your customer in another country, but it's easier for you to read it in German, then you can display it both together and you can read it directly in German and talk with your customer in English, and you can scroll it and see all the time on the left side the English and the right side the German. That is one idea, but also one problem in standards is you're not ready with one standard. In each standard you find something like test this according to IEC, blah, 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 and so on. So you jump from one standard to the next standard. So for the real usage, it might be of interest for you to have your own compilation of a standard. But you cannot say, I want to read an EMC standard, for example, only for dishwashers. You do not get it. Our idea is we named it MapView, which describes here the complete area of electromagnetic compatibility standards in the area of emissions, in the area of disturbances in supply systems, and, for example, immunity. And when you want to know a little bit more about the immunity of a dishwasher, then you can have such a compilation, which is collected from different standards. And now you can read, for example, here, that you have to do a fast transient test with each such a list. And at the end, you can say, OK, I want to do this test. Show me, please, the details. And then you see detailed the test setup and included with a picture how you have to set it up. In the real standard, you will find at that place, for example, three pictures, one for tabletop equipment, one for floor standing equipment, and one for free area tests. But for the dishwasher, it is absolutely clear you needed only the picture for the floor standing equipment. So automatically, you see only that picture. And the idea is not to copy these texts and pictures together. You make a compilation so that with one click, you can jump from English to Chinese, to Japanese, to French, to German. That is the idea behind. So much from our vision of working with standards in future.
Thank you very much. That looks like a
very flexible and indeed colorful tool to me. Why is it that it looks like internet pages we all know? Why is it that it's taking so long? Why is it still future?
The problem is our standards at the moment are in Word format or PDF format, more or less electronic thick books. And our internet pages, as we know them today, are normally made out of content management systems. And exactly that is what we need. Therefore, we need content management systems where we have each single paragraph, each single picture directly addressable. And then we can make such things out of that.
OK. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to contribute to this or state their opinion on that? Okay. Oh, there's a lady.
Hi, I'm Mary from Toronto CSA Group. My question is, what would the funding model be for something like that? Would you pay for access to the app? Or is all the data available for free?
That is a vision. that is not an app.
Yeah.
There's a few more functions I didn't show, but there is no real function. It's only a vision.
It's a vision.
Okay. Well, if there are no more... Yes, one more over there. Okay, well, still have some microphones on the way.
I'm from Iceland, Guðmundur is my name. I was just wondering, what is your vision of this coming through? The timescale.
Again, the same answer. It's a vision, and we want to. We have started a project in DKE. We named it Normung 2020, translated in English, Standardization 2020. Maybe that is the time, but maybe we are faster. But the main problem is we as DKE cannot do it alone, because we can do it in German. It's less than half the idea. We need all of you, we need the complete IEC, so we need to move a lot of people to that target. So we have not the time schedule, sorry.
Okay. Well, I think that's it for the moment. Thank you very much, Klaus Wolfgang, for this interesting presentation. And Martin, I'd like to know your... No, not yet. No, I still want your opinion on a couple of things. I'd like to know your opinion on this tool that you've just seen. What comes to your mind?
Well, I'm with it all the way, as you will hear shortly. The point is, it is a vision. And we have to start with a vision. We can spend a lot of time working up practicalities, but unless we can get some enthusiasm behind it, we will never actually get the energy behind it. So what you'll be hearing from me is very much on the same lines. In fact, I'm wondering about going away now, because I think everything that needs to be said has already been said by these two excellent speakers. But this session, this exercise is about vision. So please bear that in mind, with everything you hear this
But would afternoon. You agree on the time scale as well?
But I would say, again, exactly the same message. The time scale depends on us, all of us. Those who are here trying to implement change, and those who are trying to demand change, who are, in fact are demanding change. Mm-hmm. And if we hear those voices loudly enough, then it will be much easier to make a case for responding to them.
Okay. Let me just, Stefan, let me ask you one thing. Dietmar's talked a lot about the custom review and the importance of that. You're in the user area, so what do you think about that?
It looks fantastic. Yeah, as a user, I type in dishwasher, I get all the requirements for dishwashers perfectly linked, I have all the links. But my question is, who is maintaining all these links? Who is creating all these links, all these connections, all these functions, which means the content must fit to the product. This must be created in the standardization committees. So it's a lot of work to create it and to maintain it. And standards for users, one important thing is they must be reliable. So if I have a standard, I'm starting my development in the companies or in the companies which are our clients, and they must rely on the content which is listed there, because a lot very expensive decisions are behind it. Yeah. Do we make it like this or like this? And so we must also keep in mind the reliability of the standards. If we have such a fantastic tool to create the content, yeah, mm-hmm. that's a little bit my concern. Who is doing the job? Because in the moment in the standardization, I know time is very expensive. Yeah, because limited.
Yes. So, Clemens, yeah, you're already from the younger generation point of view.
Yeah, so I think maybe let's not talk about a tool. For me, it's more like a platform. And then it's not a question who puts the content in. The content, they will be put in by the community. So because I think maybe it's the fear that everybody of us has a lot of work to create this tool. This will take a long, long time. And maybe then we're also too slow. So I'm more in favor to create a platform, like an app store, so everybody, also the users of a standard, can put their information in.
Mm-hmm. So is that something? I'm looking now at the future of standardization work now, where we, like years before, we used a telephone book, and now we're using Google. So what would be a greater perspective or a greater vision on the future of standardization work, Martin?
I think we need to reinvent standardization. And that's what this is about. That, you know, we're slipping back into talking old language, yesterday's language, about standards committees. You know, maybe we won't have committees. Maybe we can't afford to have committees. We won't need them. I'm not saying that's necessarily the case, but if we're going to forward in the way we're hearing about this afternoon, we need to look at the whole thing holistically. How do we deliver standardization to our user community? And that user community is changing and will continue to change, and those who are developing the standardization will also change. And in both cases, there will be different expectations, mm-hmm. and there'll be different resources.
Mm-hmm. Dietmar, you talked about the multimedia platform, so I hear a little bit of that here now. Do you think that's a very important thing also for the standardization work be done? And what would be the same media? Would it be slightly different in its weight?
I mean, the vision you just presented here, I think that's brilliant. So even if I'm not part of the business, but these kind of applications exist already in other industries. So I don't know how much you look to other industries, how they do. The car manufacturers, for example, they have...
Car manufacturers?
Yes, they have to all the different... when they're in the production line, they change, all the changes during the production line need to be monitored, and this is all in content management systems. publishers for the education industry. They use this kind of system that you can compile your own book, basically, for a certain topic. So other industries, all the elements you showed,
yes,
do already exist.
Yes.
I think, and in the media industry, there was one point when you said we need to basically standardize the standards. The NewsML was created, which is basically based on XML, to standardize the news feeds.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the same, I guess you have the same challenge now, in order to feed this platform, the standard for how this platform is fed is the starting point, actually. Mm. And but I think that's brilliant if you can. But it will take time, because these kind of discussions, as you said, also that the people who create standards need to change. This is the tricky part. In the media industry, the change has started 15 years ago, and we still haven't finished.
Mm-hmm. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'd just like to look around. If you would like to contribute to the discussion, you're very much invited to do so, and during every other discussion as well that we have during the session. Is there any statement from Ben?
Over here?
Yeah, Gens.
Oh, thank you, Jens Geiko from DKI. I have a question concerning the last part. Is it possible to separate the two steps and to say, okay, on the one hand, we work on platforms and tools for more participation, for to create the content, and on the other hand, we have a second project team, let's call it like this, and they should think about how to provide the content for the users. Is this possible, or is it a mistake? Shall we do it in one step, or is it necessary to combine it? I mean, you explained about the media industry. You had this because both changes have been in parallel, I think.
As long as this the end goal is synchronized between these two groups, it's fine to split it up. You need to carve up the elephant anyway; otherwise, it's too big.
Yeah.
So, but a shared vision or a shared goal needs to be very clear, and then split up in sub-projects.
Mm.
And so, yes, basically, it needs to be possibly in parallel. But the starting point is to have actually to know exactly where to go. And this is actually the most difficult part, because it's very difficult to envisage what will happen in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. Nobody knows. So, but to create a system or a project concept, if you like, where you are open enough to change and to be flexible enough is one part. But the second part is, again, to knowing roughly this is the direction where we want to go, and then break it down.
Mm-hmm.
This is how the media industry also needs to do it, because it's just too complex. Mm. The complexity is just huge.
Clemens, I'd like to hear your vision on on this.
I like your expression during your presentation. We have to look not from inside out, we have to look from outside in. And I think that's exactly what we have to do. And luckily, all our stakeholders, they are already users. So it should be very easy to get this view implemented in the IEC, and then we can start and get it done.
Sounds easy.
Mm-hmm. And what would be what would be a sector that comes up to your mind first to learn from?
For the sector, I think there's no preference. So, for example, how to present or how to provide standards to the user could be the first way. So as we saw here in this vision, and I think this is a good starting point.
Okay, thank you. A nice concluding remark on this part of the session. Thank you. Now, Martin, it's your turn to come up here to this, this whatever it is, column.
Whatever it is. It's
Well, I don't have to introduce you anymore. You would speak on content delivery behind our current way of thinking.
Well, I'm just going to leave the room. Okay, thank you and good afternoon. It's good to be here. I hope it's good for you to be here as well. Connecting communities. My hypothesis today is that if we are going to connect our communities effectively, we need to have connected standards. Standards work together with each other and deliver, as I rather abused the term just now, a holistic product to our user community. For the last 100 years, in fact, I heard from Christian Gabriel this morning in Austria that OVE has been going since, I think, 1883 or 1884, so it's well over 100 years, we've had disconnected standards, essentially based upon a two-dimensional concept, paper, the shape of a piece of paper. I'm going to offer you a vision for a new approach to delivering standardization, delivering it in three dimensions. Now, this has been driven by my experience and that of many of you, especially those of you in DKE, in working with the European community, the European Commission, rather, in delivering standards that relate to legislation and in assuring the community and the user community and the Commission that those standards are fit for purpose and the relationship is sound and reliable. And we're hearing and we're finding now that that's not the case. And we need to do something about that if what we call in Europe the new approach is to remain feasible, strong and effective. So the three-dimensional standardization, I say it's a question of taking it off a piece of paper and putting it into, conceptually, I have in mind a sphere, but it won't be a very regular sphere. It will more closely resemble the human brain. And that's possibly the best way to think of it, the best analogy. It's a set of vast set of neural networks from which we can mine the richness of the entire body of standardization. Perhaps, ultimately, past standardization, material that we've now put to one side, but still carries value. Certainly the material we've got at the moment, and of course, the material we're developing and taking into the forward, and taking into the future, with the intention of making it instantly available to whoever needs it and for whatever purpose. And for that purpose, you need, therefore, to rearrange the material in a deeply granular fashion. It will essentially be a database, probably based on XML, but this is not technology dependent, or specific technology dependent, but it'll be a question of identifying all the significant individual elements within each standard, methods, clauses, tables, figures, equations, maybe even specific values in a table that you know, or the committee knows, or whatever structures we have in the future that our expert base know are going to be of value to the users of those of a particular standard, as we call it now, but also for users of different standards. This is why I'm talking not about reinventing standards, I'm talking about reinventing standardization and having a standardization database. All this material could be individually addressable and compilable. Benefits for the user? Well, it would be reliable interfacing with other locations in the standardization brain. That's what we're missing at the moment. Perhaps interfacing is the wrong term. Perhaps connection is the better term. My holy grail is the elimination of normative references, because in my particular bit of the world, they create an enormous amount of difficulty in just maintaining, ensuring they're accurate, ensuring they're pointing in the right direction for the right purpose. That's a perennial problem. It has been for 100 years for all of us in the standardization community. But that's only one aspect of this. It will allow for much easier updating. It will allow for very simple regional modification. We don't particularly want regional modification, but it's a necessary evil. It's not going to go away. So a system that allows it to be introduced, switched on, switched off, just as we've heard earlier on, would be well worthwhile. It would allow do-it-yourself standardization, conceivably. How we would manage that is another matter, but the technology exists to pull elements together to give us standardization material for a new product, or to produce custom standards for individual purposes. It could be, might need to be, a new revenue stream if we're actually offering this service to our user community. They could write their own private standards from our material. What we end up with is something I'd like to think of as the dynamic standard. Benefits for us, the developing the developers and the publishing community. We have tighter, more regular structures that allow us to have faster drafting, more reliable machine translation, if you're using condensed syntaxes and condensed vocabularies, it's a lot easier to expect it to be translatable. Easy and accurate interrogation of historic material for compliance and legal issues, responsive to market demand and technological information, innovation. Together, that gives us a picture of dynamic standardization as a process and as a product. That's the important point. The opportunities are that we own this material. It's not somebody else's, it's not third party. We possess it. And when I say we, I'm now thinking of the entire global standardization community. I'm thinking certainly of IEC and ISO, probably the regional bodies, those I know and love, CERN and CERNELEC, and possibly others, where we fit in some of the other organizations like IEEE. I'm not going to go there. That means there will be no persistence problems because this material is under our control. We have the experience, expertise, and connections. Many of ourselves, us as standards bodies, are already moving down this line. We need to work together much more closely so that we deliver a joined-up product in a joined-up vision. So a new flexible product offering opportunities for a wide range of our user community. In particular, we do have a problem for the SME community in delivering material which they find far too expensive and far too complex. Now, before you start asking the questions, I have not considered the commercial aspects, the costs, which would be immense, no way around that, the impact on business models, which would be significant. But this is about reinventing standardization. It's about reinventing everything we do. And if we don't do it, somebody will do it for us. And I haven't looked seriously at market demand, except for my own little niche, where in the medical devices area, we have a serious problem and people are shouting at us very loudly. And I haven't considered technology and architecture. Almost certainly, it would probably have to be developed incrementally around discrete nodes of material, such as the medical devices area, but building up eventually to a very much larger package. Timescale, well, as I said before, it's not going to be done in 6 months. It might be done in 6 years. It might take 60 years. Who knows? But unless we start somewhere, it's not going to happen. And what's going to happen to us? I know what's going to happen to me in 60 years. I don't know about the rest of you. But the picture at the moment is not very pretty unless we make some radical changes to the way we go about delivering what we're all about. Challenges, finally, cost and resource, obviously. The difficulty of managing collaborative relationships. We are all very guarded about what we do. We're not going to tell anybody what was going on until we've taken it to market, in case somebody else gets there first. We can't go on like that. That doesn't work. Cultural change, it'll be a cultural change for the users. Not a huge cultural change. Big cultural change for the developers. I think we're going to have to see new models and paradigms of standards development. It'll be very much more on an open forum basis, nonetheless with effective consultation and effective validation. But I think the days of the formal committee structure focused on one particular technical application, I suspect they're numbered. And publishers, of course. Big cultural change for us as publishers and the way we do things. So, that's my vision. And this is just a vision, but I do believe we need to have visions. Just finally wanted to just have a look at that. That's DK's vision for this week. What do you think of it? It strikes me as two-dimensional. Look at the dots around the edge. How do you get from one to the other? You go all the way around and down the other side. That's not the way we've got to go. We need a stronger vision to ensure that everything is joined up. That's it from me. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Quite a vision. And I'd like to ask the audience what your comments on that would be. Is anybody there who would like to say something to that? How that feels? Yes. The microphone is...
Martin, just to your last sentence, you told the DKE vision would be two-dimensional. It's a nice view, but if you take a picture from the universe, you get a two-dimensional picture, and that's the view of the DKE.
Depends how many cameras you use.
Okay. Right behind, yes.
Martin, you know that I completely share the vision, also that was presented by DKE. For me, it's clear the problem we struggle with is the implementation, obviously. And what I like about your presentation actually is that you have shown benefits for the developers. And I think that's the key to go down this road, because we can come up with business models for each of the different sectors, and we will find it very difficult to come up with a return on invest for this specific stuff. For example, just going back to the dishwashers, I mean, it puts half of the test facilities out of business if this works. That's one issue, for example, because if you can automate tests, it's clear I don't need these nice facilities. I need half of it. Yeah? Mm. So, and there are not many test facilities who are actually doing spinach tests, dishwasher tests. I mean, I'm not doing that at home. So it is clearly a difference in the audience, in the users of the standards. And as you said, starting with specific sectors might be an idea, but I think we need to start at our own. We need to give benefits to the developers by using such data-based methods so that we, as a writer of the standard, can benefit from it.
Mm. Okay. Yes. Stefan, we heard a lot of interesting ideas here. I picked up the do-it-yourself standard. So what is your opinion on such?
Yeah, do-it-yourself standards could be a good idea. Could be a good idea in a way that typically our standards are stable. Uh-huh. That's one thing that is good. Yes. On the other side, it's not good because they are too stable. We all know it. After you have published it, you will recognize you need to modify it, because the users of the standards will come to the committees and say, oh, we found this is not possible to do it like you have described it in your standard, and so on. So we must find solutions between the issues of the standards, of the stable issues, to introduce new content in a way like, maybe as you give it in forums, or you make a comment and you can read it as the user of the standard. This is very helpful. So I also agree with the gentleman there that the basic thing for IEC to start with this project is to have a tool to introduce the content, or to make the content more digital, so that you can access it. At the moment, it's like a story. You read it in a book.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a story, and you must have an interpretation. And for this interpretation, you need experts. In the future, you may have a little bit more digitized information, and this digitized information can then be from this database. You can create new forms of presentation of content delivery of usage.
Okay.
My dream, for example, is I have a test lab, so maybe half of me will be away in the future. But at the moment, I dream I download the standard into my machine. The machine says, please make the setup like this. And I am available to do this test, and then the test is done.
Okay. Clemens, tell us about what you think about Martin's presentation and what comes up to your mind.
Yeah, I think definitely such a database is the basis for the future of IEC. And this opens then the opportunity to offer different interfaces, because the user, as you mentioned, might not be always a human. This could be also then a machine or whatever. And so that we can actively interact between the IEC and their stakeholders. So, and I think this is also a huge financial benefit for all companies. And I'm pretty sure this is something to get also the return of investment for such a database.
Okay, Dietmar, when you heard that, what is, from your outside perspective again, I'd like to know what comes up to your mind.
A few things, actually, because one is it's very pleased to see that not only our industry needs to change, and that change is so difficult, because all these programs are brilliant as long as there are no people involved. So as soon as you put the human factor in it, everything becomes really awkward. But regarding the database, what the media industry is struggling with also, like you have, the standards are like a story. So we are now actually working also very hard to get it on a granular level so that all the elements of a text in our case is basically, it's not seen as a story anymore, it's just one component, and they are connected with, it's like a relational database, and whoever developed the database remembers maybe to normalize it down to a one-to-N relationships. And this is one of the biggest challenges to get away from this page view, which is also the media industry still looking at pages. Secondly, it's not only the content that is crucial, but also the metadata that describes the content. Because as soon as you talk to machines, they can't read they don't understand what is happening here. So the metadata that describes the content is the second biggest challenge in the media industry, to automate it, to make it machine readable. So the easiest cases is if a newspaper outlet wants to create an automatic portal for sports content, I'm making this up now, then the metadata needs to help the publisher to basically that no human is involved anymore and you can compile it. And I could imagine that this is a similar challenge with metadata is in the standardization industry.
Yeah. Martin, do you agree?
Yeah, I would agree. Yes. I mean, there are some significant technical challenges, but I think the technology which would underpin all this is with us now, ultimately. Yes. It's a question of scaling it up, it's a question of financing and resourcing it, but the technology, I believe, is there. We just got to be a bit bolder about using it. And as I say, we might need to start incrementally, but we need to start somewhere. Just a point about the human factors. I think that, again, that's a very valuable point. But many of us who are closely involved in standardization are seeing that that's really sorting itself out anyway. We are losing people. We're also gaining people, but there's a constant turnover in our standardization community. So if we start entrenching a new culture, then that will spread out. I don't think that's going to be a major problem, apart from those possibly holding the purse strings or sitting in the big chairs and feeling quite comfortable there. They're the ones who are going to be the problem.
Okay, we have a comment from a contribution from Jens.
Yeah, thank you exactly for this one. I think when we prepared the Reinvention Lab, we thought about what could be a motto, and then we decided on the homepage. We have the statement from Franz Reiswig, from Michael Teigler, and myself. I added the comment to say we should go from standard writing to standard engineering, because what we have today is, as you said, Dietmar, it's in former times it was a writing process of a whole article, but now it's more engineering of content with all the metadata and so on. Mm-hmm. But if I look into the TCE and working group meetings and so on, I have the feeling there are some artists in. Basically, maybe they have been an engineering background, but they act more as an artist to write it. And sometimes I hear a sentence, okay, you achieve consensus if you found a wording where everyone in the room can interpret in a way like he or she wants to interpret it. But as long as we have these sentences in the standardization world, are we really ready? Can we go on? I think there still we have a lot of work to do with this to change this mood. So Martin, do you think the time is right? Can we change it? Or if I ask Clemens, I'm pretty sure we are.
We are.
Yeah.
But to get such huge change implemented, I think it's also really, really important to get the young people involved. So I think it's very important to transport this message that the IEC is really willing to set up a new IT, a database and all the such things to the young generation. And I think these are definitely topics people are keen on, and they will come.
Oh yeah, so more diverse teams and
If you look outside at the TC at the future standard stand, you can see a tool web-based and everything is based on database. You can see which one has made a comment and everything. And this tool has to be enriched with metadata and the possibility to include links and so, but we have the technology right now.
Mm-hmm. Would you just hand it over? It's just behind you.
Ingrid Blank, DKE. Just an example for change and metadata. I'm involved in committees dealing with information structure in the widest sense. And they use XML language and metadata. But even in those committees, it's only a few specialists who really are within the scope. The change, really doing that change. But I think it's the only chance we have to do it like that. But it's difficult for us. We have to, for our brains, it's less concrete. You have to use concrete, special things, techniques, technologies, and knowing, technological knowings, then transfer them, abstract them to the metadata. Well. Mm. That's the difficulty, but I don't think we can't do it without it.
I'm seeing, yeah, there was a comment there. Another, no?
Yeah, just to add another aspect to the discussion. Most of my standardization life, I've been working with systems committees rather than product committees. And my observation is the more we get into complex systems, the less easy it is to write precise values, limits, test procedures. They have their existence and they will continue to have their existence. But when we go to discussions like how will the electrical network of the future look like, how will be communities connected by social media, etc., we are defining concepts which are unknown to standardization yet. And I think it is worth to be aware of that. That means we have different types of standards, and these may require different approaches to generate them, and also then to exploit the knowledge that is within them, because standards are codified knowledge. Mm-hmm. And we want to ensure that people know if we apply that standard, we are going the right way. So maybe we should not forget that aspect. Thank you.
In a more complex world, Clemens?
Yeah, I'm really happy about this discussion because when I came first in contact with the DKE, I never talked about XML or something like this. I tried to find the right standard in a database. I was not really sure how to handle. Yeah. And I think this is the future, these topics, also for the young generation. Okay.
We're witnessing a very vivid discussion here. There's the gentleman back there again. Can you, Jay? Thank you.
You know, Roland Hussein from Toronto. You know, yesterday we talked about the life of a standard. We also talked about the life of a product and the linkage. So, if I had a dream for a dishwasher may have 500 pieces to it. And those 500 pieces may all have connections to standards. If it is nickel, is it stainless steel nickel? There are standards to that. And when you put the whole together and the energies that you need, there are standards to that. So if I had a dream and I have to make a dishwasher, wouldn't it be nice that I can call up the parts and I can get the standards automatically? This is where I believe that both parties have to be talking rather than create the standards here and hope the user can use it. When my dream is to make the dishwasher and I have to tap into all of that and a section within a standard, how do I do all of that smoothly? Because the base is really the user community.
Martin,
Would you?
Oh, absolutely. Like, yeah, I mean, that is precisely my dream. I mean, this is the problem we're having in the medical devices area, because it's drawing on so much knowledge. And thank you very much for Thomas for bringing that word in, knowledge. This is exactly what it's about. It's about data that can compiles into information and then has the status of something really solid and reliable, knowledge. And we need this to have this reliable knowledge that comes from all sorts of different places, even for a relatively simple product like a dishwasher or washing machine. Just a brief anecdote about my experiences with the European Commission when they were assessing some of the medical device standards. They looked through the references list and said, okay, there are 20 references here. Let's follow them up. And then they went down the next stage and looked at all the references that are supposedly indispensable in those 20 standards. And they thought, okay, well, let's go down a bit further. And they said, eventually, when they got to somewhere near the end of the chain, because you never get to the end of the chain here, you would need to have 700 standards in order to apply just the one that you're dealing with. Now, that's just unacceptable, and it's crazy, and it's Stone Age standardization. You know, that might have made sense in 1880. It doesn't make sense in 2016, and that's the sort of cultural change we've got to move towards.
Well, thank you very much for this vivid discussion. And let's now move to the third part. back from Stone Age now to the technology behind. And introduction will be by Johannes Stein, and he's head of production at DKE German National Committee, and is supported by Martina Rischer, who's right there, also from DKE, and Philipp Tschirke, who is consultant for content management systems. So welcome. The stage is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction. So we heard a lot about visions and how long it might take, and that we have to take the first step, and we try to do the first step. So it's a little bit down to earth now, from the vision to reality. It's not as nice as the vision, but it's our first step what we want to do. As already heard, we have a project inside DKE where we starting with content management and translation memory systems. And it was already said, to make the vision reality, we need such kind of technology as a kind of backbone. Now, imagine there was a discussion about standards. The standard was changed, maybe in an online collaborative way, as it was discussed during the last days already, or as shown outside. And now we have these standards available in XML in a content management system. So, Philipp, what is the advantage? Why do we want to bring it in such a content management system?
A content management system is basically a system for managing modular content. This one that we see here is a web-based content management system, so anyone with a web browser can use it. And the basis for the data is XML. So we can enrich the data with structure, with semantic structure. We can add metadata, and the content management system can help us managing different versions, different languages, and links between different modules.
Thank you very much. Can you show us how it might look like?
So what we see here is a document with several modules in it, like chapters. And I have one chapter here. I can add comments, but it's just simple comments I can add. It's not like a collaboration tool what you are looking for. But I can create a new version of this document. Edit it, and now I've added another paragraph, and made a few changes, and save it. I can compare different versions. Now that I have those changes in here, I need to get them translated for the different national
normative institutions. So I can just create a new version of the whole book. Just one second.
So now you are preparing sending to the translation memory system, which is a separate system specialized on translation into a national adaption, for instance.
Yes. So now I've created another version that's a fixed point that I can go back to, which I need for the translation. And now I would just start the localization process. I would have my source language, select my target language, and I can make different settings and then just click start. I get an XML file. I maybe get pictures that are in there that need to be translated too. But I don't have to, it doesn't have to be only text and pictures. There can be videos in it too, with maybe a layer of text over the video for subtitles. All of those language-dependable sources will be exported, and I can just hand them over to a translator.
Yeah, thank you very much. So now we receive the new text in the translation memory system. Martina, you are the translator, and you are using the translation memory system. Can you show us what you have received?
Yes, I received the document with the changes that Philip made, as we have seen. But before, in an earlier phase, I did a translation of the first version, which is in the translation memory now. So I create the new project, use the text that Philip has created, and it's already in my system. So as you can see, the progress is 90%, which means there must be a difference in text, and we find out where it is. There's also the statistics saying that the document has 469 words, and here at the end we have 26 words which do not have a match, so that is the part we need to translate. So I expand the view to full screen. I'm at the top of the document. You have these two columns, the left, the English, and right, the German column. In the middle, you can see the percentage of what has been translated and what has been found in the dictionary, in the memory from the earlier version. And we have such things as 100%, which is translated. We have AT, which is automatic translation for figures and numbers. And we, as we scroll down, we have a CM, which is context match, which means we have paragraphs that match to the paragraph before and the paragraph after. And then we come, as we scroll down, to the part that Philip changed before, and where we don't have a match. We also have another thing that is this section here. We don't have a match for heat release. Let's start with this. We would probably use like Wärmefreisetzung or something. So we use this. I hoped it was in the term, but it is not. And for this, I hope I have translated. So we quick. We can then go back to home. And what I would do, I can confirm all the segments that I haven't confirmed before. But to be quicker, we go to the batch tasks. And I can say, can use all these things. I would now generate the target translation, which would transfer, which would give it back to the XML version, which I'm doing now. And I would hand this over to Philip.
Thank you very much. And this is also possible for every language, also in parallel.
This is possible for the language that we have created dictionaries for. Yes.
Thank you very much. Philip, what did you receive now from Martina?
I got the same package I sent her back, but with the German translation in it. I imported it in the system. Now I have here my document. I can say I want to publish it in German, and I want a comparison between version 2 and version 1. So I make the...
So you're now preparing the publication of a national German adaptation of an IEC standard?
Yes. It's already done. So these are the changes between the documents. This part and this part is new between version 1 and version 2. And another point about this content management system is the basis is XML. I don't have to go to PDF at the end. I can go to HTML pages. I can stay in an XML context and publicate it to the dishwasher, like you said. And the dishwasher knows what standards apply to it.
Thank you very much. So that was a brief suggestion how a short process might be look like in future, how we can be more efficient in the translation and in the national adoption of IEC standards. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you to the three of you, and thank you very much. Very interesting tool. And I'd like to ask you, what do you see or regard as the main benefit compared to your today work?
Yeah, first of all, we try to be faster, to be more efficient with such assistances, and that there's because there's no media break any longer. Now we have a stream of processes where we have a lot of different tools involved. And here, if we are using one format, it's easier then to adapt it and to synchronize it. And another point is that using this content management system, we are able to be more flexible, to use it to more products, different products. Yeah, so we are more modular. Yeah, and it can be distributed also then to different channels in the content delivery. So that's the basic idea we are following here.
Which means the customer could also benefit from such.
Hopefully, yes. We are sure. Yes,
thank you very much. And I'd like to ask the audience if there are more questions to Johannes and his team. No? Okay. Well, then, thank you very much. And Clemens, what do you think about after seeing that?
Yeah, I like all these tools or functionalities a lot. So, yeah, I think this will also help the IEC to involve as much countries as possible, because English is the language of the IEC, but it will also be necessary in the future to translate all these documents in different languages, and yeah, this might also be one of these key factors to get this implemented, such a database, and to get here a benefit for all members of the IEC.
Mm-hmm. Martin, you agree, you say?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, there's nothing I can add to that. All I would say is that reliable automatic translation has been the holy grail for a very, very long time. And now we're getting close to it. And that will make such a difference to our user community, and indeed our members, you know, who bear considerable expense and trouble, and it will also speed it up enormously. We had some interesting discussions in the management board on Monday about this, and it's politically very sensitive. So anything we can do to make it easier and simpler and more reliable is well overdue.
So what would be technologies and new processes that would be necessary from your point of view?
This translation is very important. Yes, English is the language, and so with many countries, English is enough. But even then, yes, the translation process is important, yes, from my viewpoint. But as a user of the standard, I have, let's say, other focus points.
Which would be?
the focus point is I want to interact with the standardization committee more. Uh-huh. And at the moment, the interaction is possible, yes, via IEC, but on a very slow way. So okay. You are asking IEC, I have a question. IEC is transferring this email to some secretary. The secretary is transferring it to a standard, to an expert. The expert is maybe answering, maybe not. Maybe is the understanding there, but there are so many, such a long chain. So what you are doing as a user of the standard, you simply do not apply it 100%, or you say, I know this is rubbish what is written there, but I leave it because making the effort to change it is too long.
Okay.
So what I need is more interaction. Yeah. You have. What are you doing with your? How do you buy goods today? You go to a website. I do not mention the name, but you're looking of a lot of comments there from users. And how do you select the product? Mm-hmm. How do you select what is right? Is the product good or not? You're looking in the comments, and if you find it reasonable, you say, this guy, it's maybe fit my needs. Yeah? And in such a way, I want to interact with the standard. I want to interact with the committees, and maybe the committees dissolve. In our days, we have the problem that the developers in the companies do not contribute to the standardization.
Okay.
Yeah, and I want to have more interaction into these standards to have a feedback to the standardization, and the standardization can then change the standard because it's the need of the users. This is, I think, a more important thing. However, the translation is important for many people to understand the standard, but this interaction and this to increase the speed, to include more people in the standardization. Not for such a big general meeting where I have to fly 1,000 or 10,000 kilometers. I want to contribute them maybe only for 20 minutes, but they are expert on their field.
Okay.
Contribute and then go back. And maybe they contribute in the future again.
Okay.
This is my focus a little bit.
Before we conclude with our session, I'd like to take the audience again, and then a final question. Can we have the microphone, please? Yes.
Ingrid Blank again.
Yes. Yes.
No.
Not yet.
Not really.
Do we have?
Yeah, I think now it's.
Can I just borrow yours? Let's do it this way.
Ingrid Blank again, DKE. Well, Johannes pointed out in the introduction of the speech back to Earth, and I agree with everything you and we said all, but at the moment we have simple difficulties also as users. Many experiences I made as a user, why do they use different wording in different standards? So I want to point out the content management, apart from translation, the content management, we can't handle, we can't cope with it as human beings. In different committees, even in one committee, we use different wording, and that's confusing. Because usually, as a reader of a well-defined standard writing, I expect, and I have to, otherwise we cannot communicate, even as human beings. Machines can't at all, by the way. But we all know that. But I'm confused. I think, what is the difference now between this and this? And in the end, it's no. So also, the content management is just really a step on our way. Thanks. Maybe to metadata also. It's a similar thinking.
Thank you. Comment on that?
Yeah, I can directly say fully agree.
Okay.
Fully agree, because we have to standardize the standard. We have to standardize the standard, and we have to standardize the standard creation. And exactly what she said, different words, the same word means different things in different standards, or vice versa.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. More questions? Yeah.
Yeah, Thomas Wegmann, just a reply on the past two contributions. This is exactly the problem of quality in standards. Don't forget that most of our colleagues are not native speakers, and we write texts in English. And it's sometimes really very, very difficult to understand a colleague's real intention of what he's trying to say. And I'm secretary of 4 or 5 committees in Senelec and IEC, so I'm often confronted with the view that, hey, guy, don't bore us with those bureaucratic stuff. We know what we want. We know what we mean with writing that. Don't bore us with being consistent with terminology. So we get really also different requests from the community of how far we go with our preciseness and our quality. I have no solution for that. It's just to be aware we are talking about topics that are dealt with by humans of different abilities, of different language capacities. And in the end, we must come to a good solution or a practicable solution in a given point in time. We also blame we take too long in making the standards. If we make them quick and dirty, no one can apply them. If we take more time, we are blamed we are too slow. So at some point, we have to make a compromise.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this statement. And that brings me actually to my final question. We've heard so many new ideas and great things that are on the way already. I'd like to know from each of you, what is your idea to speed up the process, to get things on the way, get things on the road? We've said in this lab, we want to take a first step. But yeah, how would we get things on the road? I start from left to right.
Okay. To start with it, we need, let's say, a base on IEC. We need a base, maybe on such a content management. And then we have to find maybe some pilot committees starting to make a standard on this base.
Okay.
And then we have to introduce the community by giving them the opportunity to vote or to give a like or dislike or whatever. And so we have to play with it, and we have to find, let's say, new modern committees starting with this.
Okay.
This would be a good idea.
Clement,
I think.
Are you well? Just one. Exchange.
I think we really have to identify all these innovative stakeholders. Yeah, give them, stimulate them, and give some best practice, some examples, so that we hopefully can, take everybody finally within the IEC into the digital world. Yeah? And yeah, so go step by step, but don't wait too long. Start now.
Dietmar, what comes up to your mind from the outside perspective again?
Yeah. In general, having the right people in the right chairs is the only starting point that is the most difficult one. Uh-huh. But all the plans you have, and all the strategies and all the concepts you develop, if you don't have the right people in the right chairs, it remains on paper. So this is the setup what we always, in any change, cultural change program, start with, is having the right people.
Okay.
I just want to build on everything I've just heard. I mean, particularly Dietmar's point that it's got to come from the top, but it has to be collaborative. We have to get into a collaborative mode of working. And that is achievable, but it's human factors. I'd just like to pick up the point that Thomas made about language, because I started in this funny old business as a technical editor many years ago. And as the token native English speaker here, I will put my hands up and say that we've got to start adopting much simpler, much more systematized language if we're going to achieve this faster working and systematic standards, modular standards, which can be the modules of which can be re-employed in different places in different ways. You just plug it in, then the language has to be a lot simpler. And that's achievable, but I'm afraid the English will have to lose some face. They'll have to make some compromises, and I'm going to be one of them.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the four of you for your great contributions and active discussion. And ladies and gentlemen, I think it's time for a conclusion right now. What I've learned is digitalization is certainly changing our lives faster, and every business has to comply with this innovation speed and even or just standardization just as well. And as I see from the discussion, there are a lot of good ideas already on the way, some low-hanging fruits from the standardization community. And yeah, as Dietmar said in the beginning, a thorough look at the customer's perspective or the customer's needs will be probably helpful. And yeah, new technology is probably one of the fundamental ingredients to have. And we will discuss all that in the future even deeper and have probably done a first step today. Thank you very much. Thank you for your great contributions and active discussions, all the participants. And well, time for me to point to our next session because, yeah, you know, we have a tight schedule in this reinvention laboratory. In only 17 minutes, we'll just continue with our next session, and it will deliver insights of the European Commission, the joint initiative on standardization. So stay right on or grab a coffee and come back here. We'll be happy to have you back here. Thanks a lot.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.